From the Rosetta Stone to the Rosetta Stele. And we do have some other, I should say, little surprises for our viewers.
Perfect, well said, yes. Last week we said lots of things, like for example, the Rosetta Stele script was painted in red originally, and the red went away, and then they found small pigments of red, so that was surprising to us. We knew also it was not basalt, it is granodiorite, which is another stone, and lots of other surprises to those who would like to see it on YouTube. Mm-hmm. But today, the last piece of surprise that I'm going to say today, and probably tomorrow there will be more surprises coming up to us, is the hieroglyphic text on the Rosetta Stele.
Was it hieroglyphic?
Uh-huh. We have hieroglyphs at the top. We have demotic in the middle, which is the cursive writing of ancient Egypt, and then Greek in capital letters. The Greek is in capital letters. The last sentences in the hieroglyphic text and others is telling us one of the greatest surprises that sprung my theory about the Rosetta Stele and its sisters. The Rosetta Stele and its sisters. That is the name or the title of my theory. Very simply, it says that this script, they are talking about the whole decree, because the Rosetta script is a decree, is a religious and a political decree between the priests of the temples and the king, the Ptolemy, the Ptolemaios. What are they telling him in the script? Thank you very much. We are going to make you a royal cult. We're going to make the king the royal cult, the royal religion in the temple. In return to what? And there is always a return. In return, that the king is going to exempt the priests from taxation. Hello?
Hello. Would you take it from this file, sir?
Right there?
Yeah. No, I mean, would you take it from this?
Sure.
Yeah?
Right.
Okay.
Okay. Shall be engraved. This decree shall be engraved upon a tablet of stone which is hard. On the words of the deity, hieroglyphs, in the writings of the books, that's the demotic, and the writing of the Greeks. That is what it's saying right in front of you here with my amazing hieroglyphic writing. Here comes the surprise. It shall be made to stand in the sanctuaries of the temples by all their names and ranks, with the three ranks of the temples of Egypt. So, from the last sentences in the Rosetta Stele, we have the proof that we have more than one Rosetta Stele. Or else, why are they saying it will be erected on the three ranks of the three temples of Egypt? And they didn't say a temple. They said the three ranks of the temples of Egypt. Let's say rank 1, rank A, rank B, rank C.
So it's more than one temple?
So this is why we are calling it and its sisters. Now, do we have this decree elsewhere? Oh, yes. In Philae temple, on the walls, there is the text. Even before Ptolemaeus the fifth, this is in the Rosetta Stele, it's Ptolemaeus the fifth, right? The surprise is we found the Stele near Damanhur, in Al-Bahira Governorate, the most amazing Bahira Governorate, in a place called Qom al-Hisn. In Qom al-Hisn, Stele is now in the Egyptian Museum in Tahrir. In the most amazing room that nobody visits. Because nobody knows that it exists. Well, put an arrow for God's sake. Tell the people that inside there is a more precious Stele than the Stele of the Rosetta, which the British took and they don't want to bring it back. So, the Stele of Qom al-Hisn is telling us the decree, which is similar to the decree of the Rosetta, but it was made in the days of Ptolemaeus the Third. So now I'm getting a more ancient text than the Rosetta, one. Two, the Rosetta is destroyed in parts of it, while this one is 95% complete. The Qom al-Hisn Stele is 95% complete. So if you want to complete the Rosetta Stele, take it from the Qom al-Hisn Stele. And that's what the British Museum did in their studies. And they made the, you know, the superimposing business of the computer. They took the Qom al-Hisn and they superimposed it on the Rosetta and they continued and completed the Rosetta using...
Yeah.
How amazing is this? So now I'm getting the more precious in the Egyptian. Bring it out, put it in a special vitrine or something, or a glass case, tell the world about it. And by this, okay, the British Museum doesn't want to bring it back. Right, we'll try to bring it back, but until then, use your
We do have other options.
And it's better. It's better, it's more
it's
complete.
More complete.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So this is my last surprise to you dealing with
the Rosetta Stone.
Talking about the British Museum and talking about our monuments outside very quickly, on this sofa and in Maspiro and others, I used to scream for the last years telling people to bring our monuments back. The reply of some of the dear Egyptians, let it be there, Bassam, they take better care of it abroad. They took very good care of it abroad. Let's all confirm that fact. Fine. But as a national person who loves his country, I want my monuments back. And I can protect it. Oh, leave it, Bassam. It's safer there. I said no. For years, people used to tell me this. Oh, authorities.
Is it legitimate?
Plus, it's not legitimate. It's not legitimate.
It's not a question of
what if you take the Statue of Liberty and put it in the
Tahrir
Square?
Exactly. I mean,
what about if you take the Statue of Liberty and put it in Tahrir Square? Is that going
How
to
How legitimate is it? It had to abide by the law.
The world is going to turn
By the way, this
silent.
Is not going to be illegal because it was ours first.
Originally ours.
Yeah.
All right? So that gives you the idea.
Yeah.
So, few days ago, well, my heart goes to the Germans and the French because of the flooding.
Yeah.
And the Seine River has flooded 5 meters and something. And now it's become a big thing. The army went down and brought the people on boats. You showed the footage on your news and everything.
And museums were shut down.
Musée d'Orsay was shut.
And Louvre.
The Louvre was closed. And they put some of the monuments in boxes. And they are going to close the boxes, and now they are sending it to the storage under the ground. Just thinking that maybe if the water went a little bit higher, or the flooding of the Seine River is going to get into... the Gioconda is still there. They didn't move the Gioconda. They didn't move the Mona Lisa till today. Until yesterday, actually. So what I'm trying to say here, what about the people when they were telling me this is safer outside? It's not safer outside.
It's safer when it comes to human beings, but whenever it comes to natural disasters, this is something which cannot be helped.
One, so the first comment is educate, and that's what we are doing. A guy like me, 130 lectures for free for the people in Sakya. That's what I'm trying, as a person who's not working for government or nothing. So.
Wow.
Look at that. All my heart goes to the French and the Germans with that crisis they are facing. 20,000 were moved out of their houses and so on, and we suffer from that. I mean, we are the people of the flooding. Egypt is the history of flooding. And then became the High Dam and the Old Dam and the locks and all the story that the Egyptians know. So the interesting thing is that there is this statue in front of the bridge that the water of the Seine would reach its toes. Now the water has went all the way up to the chest. It became a touristic visit. The people now are coming on the bridges and they are taking the pictures of the statue with the water level reaching up to here. It became tourism. It became tourism. The other day they were celebrating with a documentary on France 24.
That is the statue?
Here you go. Look at the water now reaching up. It used to reach its stars. So that gives you the danger of how the water is going up. This place, this statue has become, it's always been a visit, a place, a site. But now it became even more of a famous site for people to go and take pictures and look at it because they are wanting to know what's the level of the water going.
From so that's the level of rise?
Creating tourism.
All that is rise?
Oh, 5.5 meters.
In how many days?
And they started a few days ago, three days.
3 days would make that rise?
So that's why it's
pretty dangerous. So are we, the government is aware of that?
Our government is aware of that particular threat? I didn't read any of the comments from the Minister of Antiquities. But that's normal, my dear. Don't be surprised.
But that's dangerous.
that's dangerous, but that's for
If you want to say something about these photos, sir?
So what they did is that with that statue become, what I'm trying to say is that the French, smart enough, that they are now, without planning, they are making good out of
a good
crisis.
Good use of a crisis.
Of a crisis.
Yes.
That's what I'm trying to say. Remember in the old days, the 2011, 2012, when I said, when I introduced to Egypt and to the Minister of Tourism, the revolution tourism, nobody heard. which is I would bring the groups in Suez and I would take them to the places where the people stood and then to the museums of the city that you are visiting. Suez, it's the Suez Museum, Port Said's, Port Said, and so on. And I called it the revolution tourism. And that would be the first time. In look what the square of Concord, because it was full of blood in the days of the guillotine and all of this and the cutting of the heads and so on, and the French Revolution. Now nobody remembers the blood in the Concord Square, very smart by the French, and now everybody remembers Ramesses the Second obelisk. And now they removed the word Ramesses the Second and became the Concord obelisk. Hello. That's identity we're talking about.
Even the name? The name is the essence of everything.
It became Concord obelisk now. And a volunteer in my group, bless her, told me that in the documentary, the French gentleman was asking for, oh, well, perhaps we are never going to get our second obelisk.
Our
second obelisk. Mm. Because as you know, in the Luxor temple, there were two obelisks flanking the entrance of the temple. By Ramesses, Ramesu the Second. So now Champollion went, fell in love with the two obelisks, said to the French, bring them if you want to decorate and you want to beautify Paris. So they took one and they left the other because financially they couldn't.
The so French, they paid for it?
No, financially because of the transportation.
But did they pay for it?
It was a gift, my
It was
dear.
A gift. Okay.
It was a gift. Well, gift. two huge
So while they were transporting it, there must be damages.
And that happened. And I screamed 2 years, and I paid, I brought pictures, and the French people, and so on. Yes, there were cracks, and the French confessed. Soulier, the French writer Soulier, in his book, which is, by the way, translated into Arabic by Hayat al-Kitab,
but that's not
the
ethics.
Egyptian Dar al-Kitab, which I really love. The book is called, very, very interesting book about this, called The Great Journey of the Obelisk by Soulier, Robert Soulier. And in it, there is the report, which is made by the French, that we destroyed, that's what the French are telling about themselves. We destroyed the obelisk in our transportation way. So don't come and tell me it's safer outside. Neither human nor natural. Natural, everywhere is going to be exposed to, I don't know, flooding or an earthquake. Yes, that happens.
And humans, they have their own consent. Either they agree or they don't.
Yeah. So that's my message is that when I said that, nobody was expecting flooding in Paris and nobody would expect Louvre would be closed. Nobody. Mm-hmm. We'd expect Louvre would be closed and moving of the monuments.
Yep.
So, those 2 points were important to start with, the Rosetta Stele surprise and the Paris, all again, and finally, all my heart goes to the French, our French friends and our German friends with that flooding business. The third thing and the main topic today is food. Because food comes up at the top list, I don't know why, when Ramadan comes. So, and I tell you the funny thing last week, why I chose this topic. I was entering and some people were having like a sandwich here and a sandwich there when I was coming up. And I said, that's it, our topic, the coming topic is going about food and about broad beans in ancient Egypt. We have to confess, we Egyptians, that we are in deep, eternal love with fava beans, with al-ful al-midams, fava beans or broad beans, two names for the same thing. And eternal because 4,500 years ago, your grandma and your grandfather took fool with them in the tomb. And taking things in the tomb for two things, the soul of the deceased, and the souls of the afterlife.
That's not only beans, sir. As far as I know, that there were so many seeds, kind of seeds, in the tombs.
Interesting.
And also, as far as I know, I've read it once that some of those seeds were also mummified. I don't know if I can say so. And if with treating them with some special means, it's back to life.
You're talking about the wheat.
The barley, we're talking about cereal.
And they're trying to like rejuvenate again and recultivate, if you like, when you were saying that.
But if you can imagine, or is it normal to find that after thousands of years, you would take the same seed and cultivate it and it's gonna be alive once again? This is a resurrection.
Right, but the seeds, usually they stay the way they are for a long time,
but not thousands of years.
But you know, you are now reminding us of seeds, right?
Yeah.
And I will tell you, that one of the ancient seeds that was found and one of the ancient plants which were found in the tombs and in other places and it was planted by the Egyptians was kerub. Kharrub. Mm-hmm. And that is another thing that we are eternally in love with, especially in Ramadan, especially in the hot weather. Kerub, you'll be amazed. The kerub seed defined the very definition of the weight measure of the carrot. The word carrot, al-qirat, in gold, used by jewelers, is originally coming from the definition of the seed of kerub. Can you imagine now putting seeds of kerub
to measure gold?
To measure gold.
Yeah.
Because the word expression carrot is brought from there. It's brought from kerub. So that's interesting.
Sure.
But the most ancient three times edible kind of flower or plant or fruit which was found in the Nile Valley, you'll be amazed what? Not the fava beans, not the kerub, and not the onions, even though onions were everywhere in ancient Egypt. They loved spring onions. They loved it. It's painted, it's colored on the walls. They loved it, and they use it in many things, one of which is relaxation and so on.
Onions.
Spring onions, yes. And it is, because if you eat lots of spring onions, you feel sleepy, you feel relaxed. So you'll be amazed what was the most ancient of all. 18,000 years ago, the most ancient plant cultivated on the Nile Valley, found in prehistoric stomachs of prehistoric Egyptians.
What?
Prehistoric, that's before the unification of Upper and Lower Egypt, before the pyramids, before the obelisk, before hieroglyphs, before everything. Before there was actually a nation, there were different scattered tribes and so on, and then there is Upper and Lower Egypt. What was it? You'll be amazed. It is tiger nuts, which tiger nuts, which we call in Arabic Hab al Aziz.
It's so delicious.
Yes, so delicious, you're right. 18,000 years ago, the most ancient plant ever cultivated on the Nile Valley till today is Hab al Aziz. And now I tell you, I talked to my friend about it and she brought it and this, and they started making a study, and you can use it in your diet now to lose weight. By a number of, it used to be sold on the corniche with the guys of Lupin. Remember Termes and Lupin and so on. Hab al Aziz is always on the side. If it's chewy, it's got fibers, it's got
fibers,
it's got sweet, it's got this kind of milky kind of fluid, if you like. Now, if you go to Spain and go and drink juice, you can ask for Hab al Aziz juice in Spain. They drink it as juice now, like sobia here. Like the famous sobia in Egypt, and the rice, the milky rice drink that you would like to drink it, like in Morocco as well as in Egypt. So those types of, we have dome in ancient Egypt, and we found dome in the tombs. I always feel funny and always feel interested when I knew that the ancient Egyptian didn't only eat fool in his days, but he's taking it to the afterlife. So he's so in love with fool to the point that, or fava beans, to the point that he's taking it with him forever. That's eternal love.
Fasting, it was there with the Egyptians, with old Egyptians?
Fasting, like in Ramadan, no. Like
fasting in general?
Like in the idea, but the idea of business of you can stop yourself eating something. And I read once, for example, that Alexander III, when he lost his beautiful horse, he was so sad because the horse went with him for over 19, 20 years. Bucephalus, or Bucephalus, his famous horse, one of the top three horses in history, was Bucephalus. When it died, he felt very sad, and he went on something which looks like fasting. So fasting, the word fasting, yes, it was mentioned in history, but fasting like from sunrise to sunset and so on, that's Islam. But before that, of course, it existed.
We have many requests from the Nile TV crew, the breakfast show crew over there, and I wonder that if also many Egyptians would wonder the let's say the significance of many expressions that we use in Ramadan.
Yes.
Like sometimes the children would use some slang expressions.
Wahawi.
Right, like some songs. Mm-hmm. What does that mean?
Let's take Wahawi, Wahawi, Iyaha, because the very famous song that we all sung as we were young, and still we sing it when we are still grown up. Iyaha, let's take the word Iyaha, because in some cities it's Iyaha, and mm-hmm. in some other places it's Iyoha.
Mm-hmm.
And the third one, you'll be amazed, in a mm-hmm. song, it's Iyaha, which is this mm-hmm. in Arabic, Iyaha. Mm-hmm. This girl, Iyaha,
yeah.
This mm-hmm. I don't know, sandals, Iyaha, like mm-hmm. that. And the song goes, Bint Sultan, Iyaha, the daughter of the Sultan, because she's the
herself.
Herself.
Yeah.
Because she's always the most beautiful, even yeah. if she was not.
Mm.
She's always the most glamorous, even if she yeah. was not. Mm. She's always with the long hair, even if she was not. So the song goes, Bint Sultan, Iyaha. So
Lady of beauty, pointing, Sitt al-Husn.
Right, Sitt al-Husn, of course. So Bint Sultan, Iyaha, Lapsa of Tan. She's wearing a kaftan.
Mm.
She's wearing a galabeya. Iyaha. And so, and the goes, and the song. So I can imagine somebody saying the first syllable and everybody would reply, Iyaha, and so on. But if you go back to Iyaha or Iyoha, some people would like to link between Iyoha and Iyaha and Iyah in hieroglyphs.
Yeah.
Iyah in hieroglyphs means the moon.
Mm-hmm.
And because our month, our generous month of Ramadan, starts by we watching and inspecting the moon, so Iyah is the moon in hieroglyphics. You know who was called Iyah, the moon?
Mm-hmm.
A very famous king in ancient Egypt was titled the son of the moon, Iyah Mes. Mes is the sun, S-O-N. So Ra-Mesu, Ramses.
Ramses.
Jahot Mes, Thutmosis. So there is always the Mes at the end, which means the son of S-O-N.
Mm-hmm.
So Iyah Mes, Ahmos, Ahmos. The famous military leader of Egypt with his chariot wheels against the Hyksos or the Hikakhasut. So Iyaha, Iyah, that's one. Two, we have the very famous dessert that we all love called Luqmat al-Qadi, or the bite of the judge.
First time?
Which is, if you would like to study, you'll have to use the proverb that you use in the streets today, which is, let only kani wala mani. Don't tell me kani or mani. Don't tell me this or that. Waladu kani zalabani, and not either or neither the shop of the zalabani, the shop of the man who makes the zalabia, which is that beautiful rounded circular bowl like with honey and so on. In this proverb, it's understandable, right? But if I tell you, let only kani, don't tell me kani or mani. What's kani and what's mani? This is not Arabic. So go back in Coptic, and from Coptic go back to ancient Egypt, you'll find that kani and mani can be very close to the pronunciation of the beautiful, if you like, fat, sam wa asal, fat and honey. And if you put fat and honey, you can make the zalabia, you can make luqmat al-qadi, you can make this dessert. So don't tell me the fat or the butter and the honey, and don't even mention the shop that makes
the
them.
The whole shop.
Or the shop that makes them. Don't give me that headache. So don't tell me kani or mani.
Right.
And that Mr. happens when you make them between the words.
Unfortunately, our time is out. And but you promised us that you're going to be with us in Ramadan.
Inshallah.
We had your promise on air. You're going to be our host on every Sunday. And Mr. Bassam Shammah, the historian and author of Egyptologist, thank you very much for coming. Happy Ramadan.
Happy Ramadan to you.
And now it's going to be Dina Yunus. First, we're going to listen to a song that is talking about Ramadan or celebrating the coming of Ramadan, start of the holy month. And then Dina Yunus is going to take us on a tour to watch the feathers of the ostrich and how could we manufacture lots of things out of that particular item. Stay with us. Ramadan.